Sisters and brothers, I'd like to express my deepest and most profound appreciation to the families of Moses de Jesus, Philip McCall, Kenneth Griffin, and Brother Choice, Barre Choice. I'd like to thank them for their courage, for their willingness to come before us and to share with us the struggle and the pain that they are experiencing as a consequence of the murder or the kidnapping of their children. I would like to say that although we come here talking about justice for the African community, the reality is that there is no tradition in this country of justice and democracy for our people. I think that we need to keep that in mind, and we need to understand that even the birth of this country and the social system in this country that's referred to as capitalism, even the birth of this system came at the expense of the rights and the freedom of our people. You know, sometimes it's necessary for us to look around ourselves and see the conditions that we live in. Look at our communities. Look at the fact that African people in this country are dying early deaths, sometimes of curable disease. Look at the fact that the prisons are being stuffed with African people. We have to ask ourselves, how is it that we find ourselves in the situation that we are confronted with? Some people want to point to the Republican Party or some other recent phenomenon as being responsible for our conditions. But the reality is, there has never been a time since we have been in this country where we have known freedom and democracy. That in fact, we came here as part of a process that took our freedom and democracy away from us. How is it that wherever you look in the world, the vast majority of the people in the world are poor? The vast majority of the people in the world are suffering from violence, from ignorance, from poverty. There are many places in this world where people just like us have to walk miles most of the day just to get wood that they use to cook food. Why is it like that? That only a handful of people in the world today live like kings and queens? Why is it that we live in a country with perhaps 6% of the world's population, but 80% of the world's resources are located here? These are important questions, because when we began to look at it, we come to understand what happened to Philip McCall. Because although the McCall family feels this pain in a serious way, and although the fact that Kenneth Griffin died in another place here in Philadelphia, and it looks like these are just random acts of violence, random acts of brutality that's happening, the reality is that it happened to them precisely because they are black people, precisely because they are living as a colonized people right here in Philadelphia. The reality is that African people, the Puerto Rican people, the vast majority of the peoples of the world suffer poverty and oppression as a part of a process that gave rise to the richest country in the world. That it was the enslavement of African people that gave rise to what people know as capitalism today. Was no such thing as capitalism before black people were enslaved. The reality is that when we met white people, they were poor. They were chased out of Europe by disease and poverty. Okay. They had nothing. That is exactly why they left Europe, because they were poor and starving.
Yes, sir.
They went to Africa, ripped off Africa, stole we don't know how much gold and other resources from Africa. I know 500 years ago, 1400, the Portuguese has stolen 700 tons of gold from Africa. I know the British went into China in 1800s and fought a war to turn the whole Chinese nation into a nation of junkies, forcing them to take drugs, and that drug money went back to Britain, building what we now know as capitalism.
Okay.
I know the French invaded what is known as Vietnam and turned Vietnam into a country of junkies, forced the Vietnamese people to use drugs. And all of the resources of most of the loot coming from Vietnam into France came from drug money. I know that African people were kidnapped and thrown all around this world. And it was, in fact, the trade in black people that was a condition for giving rise to this system that they know as capitalism, that we refer to as white power. I know that when white people came to the Americas initially, there were only approximately 70 million white people on the planet Earth. There were more than 200 million so-called Indians here. And by the 1888, 98% of the Indian people had been killed as a part of the process of enriching white people, creating white power and capitalism. If they would kill 98% of the Indian population, why in the hell don't you think they will come in your neighborhood and kill your children in order to keep everything that they stole? Of course they will.
Of course they will.
The problem that you and I have is when we begin to believe in the lie of what America is about. America has never been about anything other than slavery and genocide. There is no tradition of democracy for black people in this country or any place else in the world. And if we are going to have democracy and freedom and justice, it will come as a consequence of our coming together to organize, to take that justice, to take that democracy, and to take that freedom for ourselves. This is what we have to understand. America is not about to give us freedom. If it hasn't given it to us in the 500 years that we've been in touch with it, why in the hell do you think it's going to give it to you just because you happen to be on the scene today?
Okay.
No such days as that.
No such days.
We are going to have to organize to fight for our freedom.
Okay.
If we do not organize, we shall never be free. If we do not organize, we should never be free.
Okay.
So we have to organize.
We do.
Here in Philadelphia, a city where they would drop a bomb on an African community, destroy an entire African community, kill 11 people, babies and other children, men and women, have no disregard for black life, would come into the backyard of somebody who's just doing nothing but chilling with their grandchildren, and take their lives, snuff their lives out as though it meant nothing. We'll come into the basement where another family lives and find a man naked with his children and snuff his life out and won't even offer you an explanation. And you know why they won't offer you an explanation? Because they assume that you're not organized. Because they assume that they don't have to give you an explanation because you got no power. But the road to power is through organization. There are a lot of people and organizations that exist out here today who would tell us that the way we have to get our freedom is somehow making our enemies like us. They offer us a stupid platitude, sometimes silly rhymes like up with hope and down with dope. They say things like this that make no sense, that contribute not one iota to our freedom.
Right.
Sisters and brothers, there are folk who want to convince us that the way we are supposed to get free is somehow to integrate into the American system. But you don't have the power to integrate. You don't have any kind of power. They tell you what you're supposed to do is fight against racism. But what is racism? Racism is an idea in somebody's head. Racism is an attitude that white people have about you. It's not an idea that kills you. It's not an attitude that killed Philip McCall. It was a bullet. It was a gun. It was white power that did it. And if you want to stop them from killing us, then what we have to fight for is black power, the power of our own lives. So whether they like us or not, they don't have the power to do anything to us. You understand what I'm saying? That's what it's about. That's what it's about. We are the only people in the world that white power has tricked. Have us walking up and down singing, "We Shall Overcome," trying to get the lynchers to like you, trying to get the ones who kidnap you to like you. Look at where you are, if that's what your struggle is organized around. If they got you organizing, trying to make your enemies like you, you can't never fight your enemy back. You don't have to have the police on the street. He don't worry about you. You can't fight him. Because if you hit him upside with a brick, he won't like you. And if he won't like you, you've defeated yourself. Don't you understand the logic there?
Yes, sir.
The question is not whether they like you. Hell, I doubt if they like the Chinese any more today than they liked the Chinese yesterday. But the Chinese are organized. The Chinese have atomic weapons. The Chinese, they don't want to jump on China, not because they don't like them, but because China is organized and powerful. If you want to stop them from killing black people, then what we have to do is get organized and fight for power. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Has to be our own power. That's what the struggle is about. Sisters and brothers.
Yes, sir.
There was a time right here in this country, several times, we've never been a passive population. They've never just been able to bring us into slavery without having a fight of their lives on their hands. There's never been a time since we've been in this country where we haven't fought against them. There's never been a time where we accepted slavery, where we accepted humiliation, whether we accepted the attacks that's come on our people and our culture. We have always resisted and we always will resist until we win this freedom that belongs to us. In the 1960s, we were part of a magnificent revolutionary movement. Some people today try to pretend that the revolution didn't happen. But a revolution happened in this country as serious as any revolution has ever happened any place in the world. It was a revolution that was defeated. A lot of folk try to act like it didn't happen. You even got an old Negro in this city. He's at one of the universities who was around in the 60s. His name is Bobby Seale. I think he sells cookbooks today. But there was a time when he was a member of the Black Panther Party. And when he was a member of the Black Panther Party, he was a member of an organization that stood in the center of the revolution in this country and one of the revolutionary movements of the world. Now Bobby Seale wants to act like the revolution didn't happen. There were a lot of people running around who were trying to make you believe that the 60s was an accident. It was just a time when white people in San Francisco and Haight and Ashbury were running up and down the streets chanting, "Make love, not war." They want to act like it was just some youthful thing that was happening with black people here. But I want to tell you that in the 60s, revolution was the main trend in the world. Revolution was happening everywhere in the world. And what am I talking about? I'm talking about poor people in China. I'm talking about poor people in Vietnam. I'm talking about poor people in Cuba and other parts of Latin America who had decided that they wouldn't live as slaves anymore. And people had begun to organize to fight for their own power. Revolution was the main trend. Revolution was happening. The Cultural Revolution was happening in China. The Great Cuban Revolution had happened in 59. The revolution was trying to happen in places like Nicaragua and all over the world, and revolution was happening right here in this country as well.
Right.
And our revolutionary movement was defeated in the 60s. But I'll tell you, there's nothing like a revolutionary movement. How do you know when a revolutionary period is upon you? The key factor, the key feature of a revolutionary period is the masses of ordinary people are drawn into political life. All the masses of people are drawn into political life. You see, every now and then, you see movements happening where people are professionals going to this demonstration and that demonstration. In fact, that's all they do. If you go to a demonstration in New York, you run into the same people in the demonstration in Philadelphia, the same people in Houston, Texas. But you know that you are approaching a revolutionary situation where you see ordinary masses of people coming into political life. People who never